this is, and if you want to, you know, talk about certain stuff, that's cruel.
But all right, I'm going to talk about everything. You can delete what would bring disgrace. Just delete the disgraceful things.
When I was just a little girl, I asked my mother, what will I be? Will I be pretty? Will I be rich? Here's what she said to me.
Decided she was going to have me, and she picked the most beautiful bush she could find, and I was laid underneath the bush. Every time I go to Grundy Park, I often wonder what bush is mine. And I did study botany. If they'd only left me the Latin name, I would know exactly what bush. Oh, my father taught me many good things.
What did he do?
He was a bellhop. He always had a job, just depending on wherever he wanted to go. He was well known, a popular bellhop, Tom Hathaway. Yes, indeedy. When I was very young, maybe 4 or 5, he would take me to his shows to see big, you know, extravagances. And when they're playing the music in the beginning, the overture, he would tell me, go ahead. I'd get out in the aisle and I would dance the things he showed me. Now, he showed me how to turn this way and that way, and then he showed me how to do the scotch thing. So I'd be out there and he would applaud, you know, and oh boy, I just carried on and I was very young. But this was great fun going to the shows with my dad because he always let me be the performer.
He also used to say that you guys were related to...
Anne Hathaway.
Yeah. And you never... But that wasn't necessarily the truth, or you never really knew with him?
Well, I don't know. He was smiling when he told me. I don't know whether he was laughing or just being nice. My mother was only 4'11", with bow legs. And when she walked, she had that funny walk.
Yeah.
And she was tough. 4'11" of top. And you know, I was walking down there. We went down a certain alley to Alvarez Street. You know, I guess the alley went through, we got off here. And I remember passing the garage. Of course, I've read fairy stories about giants and this and that. And I saw a giant finger come out and go like this. And I ran home and told my mother, and she went back ready to fight, boy. It was some guy's Peter. He was trying to get my attention. We were all living in Los Angeles, and my mother was working, my father was working, and they had a woman in there that was took care of us kids. So my mother got jealous of the woman, because I remember her asking me, does your father hug and kiss whatever her name was, Marie or something like that? And I said no, and she said, are you sure? So then I knew she wanted me to say yes, so I said yes. Yeah, and then they had a big fight. My dad got insulted and mad. The babysitter left. My dad left. And there was my mother with us two kids. Now, we figured that because he went to work in L.A. and then went to work in San Francisco, as long as he left from L.A., he must be in San Francisco. So my mother says, come on, we're going to find him. And we started down the highway. She had to stand there, and she stepped forward, lifted her arm, stuck her thumb out. Next thing I know, we're hitchhiking. And they'd take us as far as they could. And when my mother, we got out of the car, and my mother got out of the car, they always gave her some money. She said, no, no, no. They said, for the children. So she parted money. And whenever we wanted to eat dinner, she'd go to a restaurant and say, Now, I don't want anything for myself, but if you have any leftovers or anything, if you would just give my children some food. And she said, I'll wait table for you or something to pay for it. And he said, no, we'd all get a nice big feast. Yum, yum, yum. You know, I love that I found, that's something I learned on the trip. Yeah, we got to San Francisco, and she went to a couple of hotels, and she found out he had been working there, but he had just left and gone to Santa Cruz, which is not too far away. But she liked the idea so much of taking a trip for free and getting paid for it. So what she did was she said, now, don't you want to see your cousins? And he said, yeah. And she said, we'll go see our relatives in Canada. So we hitchhiked from San Francisco to Canada. And on the way, I learned many things. I learned, you know, our shoes gave out, and I learned how to put cardboard in there to cover up the holes. And then one time we rode in a boxcar, what called riding the rails. But of course, we were inside. I don't know what she did, but she talked to one of the inspectors and got us a ride for 100 miles in the boxcar. And I'm sorry she did, because my butt was really tired. You know, those wooden boxcars, they don't have enough straw in them. Another time, we were walking across the desert, and it was getting towards evening. We didn't have a ride yet, and it was getting dark, so we had to stay someplace. And there was a little house out there. Evidently, somebody used to stay there. We got in there, and there was a lot of magazines and a couple of benches and a wooden stove. So she took the magazines, put in the wooden stove, and burned up all the magazines to make it warm in there, because it's cold in the desert at night, I can tell you that. And when we were laying there, she kept some of the magazines. I remember those were our blankets. She always thought there was a man trying to get us kids away from her. And so she would lock the door and give me the key to hide. I'd hide it, and then I'd ask her, well, he didn't come, he couldn't get in. She said, but I knew where the key was. I let him in. She said, he hypnotizes me. I do remember one guy.
She married on the trip?
I think so, yeah. It was one guy. Thanks. And I remember he had a very red neck. And I would be sitting on my mother's lap, and he'd push me off, and I'd say, you leave my mother alone. I remember saying that. And I don't know what happened, but somehow I think he was the guy. Because he did have a farm. But somehow I slept through a marriage. But we eventually, I think after about 2 weeks, 3 weeks, got to my cousins in Detroit. And we went across the border to Windsor. And that's where I stayed while my mother went around to see the other relatives with an aunt there.
The ones I stayed with were Protestants, and they were very religious. Every night, we would gather around for the prayer meeting. He would talk to us, you know, something out of the Bible, and then sometimes he'd say, does anybody else have anything to say? And everybody would say something. And it came to me, and I farted.
Did you plan that, or was it just a...
No, I didn't plan. It was off the top. She brought us back. See, he sent money. She finally read, I let him know, I guess, where we were, and he sent money. She probably wrote and said, send money to come home. But she spent it on all her relatives, because they had been nice to us, so she bought things for them to repay them. And we hitchhiked back.
You hitchhiked all the way back again? Oh, God.
We finally got back to Los Angeles before we went to San Diego. And some people picked up us kids and put in a home there, because she had made the remark that before she'd let that man get us, that she would kill us. Of course she never would. That was just a silly remark. That's where we went to San Diego. And that's when he told her, he said, I don't trust you anymore. You will get the children and take them with you. So he got so nervous about that, he said, I'm going to go to the police and stop you from taking the kids all the time. And so she said, ha. And so he went to the police station and she was following. And I said, come on. You know, I didn't think he was going to do anything, really. We got there and he told his story to the police and they put her in the off the net place, you know, insane asylum down there. And she wasn't really insane, she was just nuts.
But really, because she wasn't...
Well, you see, she had a goiter and she wouldn't have it removed. And so it was pressing on a nerve to her head and making her think strange thoughts. They put her in the hospital there. They took out the goiter, but it was too late. She still had strange ideas. And he couldn't do anything for her there because she was a Canadian citizen. So they deported her. That's when my father started taking care of us himself, all by himself.
Where did she end up living for her?
Well, she ended up in Toronto at a home. We went to school and everything, but on his days off and days when we could go, we would go to the horse racing in Tijuana. We were living in San Diego at the beginning. I liked the horse races. I would give him, you know, I'd tell him the names of the horses I wanted him to bet. And underneath the grandstand, they had gambling, the Wheel of Chance, poker, the whole bit. He would put me by the Wheel of Chance with a handful of quarters, and the man behind the wheel was a friend of hers, his. So I learned the system. My father taught me many things that were very good. I learned the system. You bet one quarter, okay, you lose it. Because you lost the one quarter, you bet two quarters. And if you lose that, you bet four quarters. And then when you win it all back. Anyway, one time when we were living in, that was Los Angeles, when we were living in San Francisco, he worked for a bootlegger. And I remember him sticking the bottles in his pants here and buttoning his coat when he had to make deliveries to the, you know, to the bootleg places. Now this fellow he was working for had to go on a vacation or had to go someplace, maybe to get whiskey. But he also makes whiskey, you know, the bathtub gin type of thing. So my brother and I and my father stayed at his place, and my father let us help him make the whiskey. I remember breaking up the mash, and then I remember my brother gonna siphon it and getting a mouthful of 100% alcohol. Anyway, we stayed there until the bootlegger got back.
Well, he was going at that time with a manicure. And she showed me how to fix my nails and all that. So I would sit there and fix my nails and become beautiful while they were off somewhere. I don't know what they were doing, but you never know.
When I was just a child in school, I asked my teacher, what should I try? Should I paint pictures? Should I sing songs? This was her wise reply.
I was at 14. You know, when I went to school in San Diego, I had a best girlfriend. So they come up to see me, and I went to their house in San Diego, and this best girlfriend was running around with sailors. And she took me out and showed me how cute they were with their little bell bottoms.
and we would go dancing and all that. We'd go out dancing all night long, having drinks, carrying on. My best girlfriend taught me. Anyway, the mother phoned or wrote to my father and said, I can't handle these girls, you have to come and get your daughter. And I knew it was coming, so then we went and we hid at one of the sailors' places. And that's where I found out about dirty old men, too.
The oh, kindness no. of strangers.
Well, once I'll tell you, the nice, three nice things, I mean, that people tried to help me. One was, it was a Catholic priest. He paid for my stay in a hotel one night and told me, now when you get up in the morning, contact your folks and go home. So I didn't. I got up and left, and I thought, oh boy, I had a nice, good night's sleep. One of the sailors, who I really was crazy about to this day, he took me to a girl's home, and he had to pay. I could live there, and he would pay 50 cents a week for me to stay there. And, well, I was used to running around at night, and they had a curfew. You don't go out after 9 o'clock. So I went out and never came back. And I figured he kept paying the 50 cents, I don't know. I used to go up to a sailor, and because I didn't have any money, I was sleeping on the roofs, you know, of apartment buildings. You know, you go right up the stairs and they have that little house. So I would go up to a sailor to get, you know, to get food. I said, you know, I haven't had a thing to eat all day. And he says, oh, I don't eat much myself. But I'll tell you, they would want to take you out for drinks, but they never wanted to feed you. One girl said, now, you need money, and this old man will pay you $20 for, you know. So I went to see the old man, and then the old man, even though he was a dirty old man, he wanted to have me stay there, and he would take care of me. But right now, that was during Hoover when he, you couldn't take your money out of the bank. All you could get was the interest off your money. So he was living on the interest. He didn't have too much money. And so as long as I was staying there, he was trying to help me for me to tell everybody that he was my uncle. Now, we know what uncles are. So my dad came down and took me home. When I was home, I went out and I met some, you know, started running around like I was doing down there. And I ran into this girl and I brought her home and I said, this is my girlfriend and everything. And my father says, I don't want you running around with bums like this. And I stood up for my girlfriend and I left home again. So, I mean, that's the way I left home. I loved my father loved me, but, you know. You know, I always said I was older, you know, 21. And
how old were you then?
I was about, oh, at that time I think I was about 16. This one girl that I met, she said, I can get you a job in Seattle. If you come up, my mother is in a wheelchair and you can help her with the work. And then, if you want to, you can go back to school and still live there and help her when you're home. I thought, boy, that's a good deal. So I went with her to Seattle, went to Broadway High School, and I was helping the mother. I ran into a fellow followed me up that I knew before in Los Angeles, and he wanted to marry me. We spent the night, you know. When I went to the school the next day, the woman who I was working for had complained that I was out all night. So the principal and the girl's advisor took me into this office. They said, what were you doing all night? And I said, well, I was making love. And they said, what do you mean making love? I said, I'm only human. But the principal called me aside in one of the rooms that were being redecorated. called me out of class. He said, you know, Grace, if you were to make good grades all through high school, I will see that you go to college. And he's giving me this, well, of course. You know, he's giving me this. And I said, ha ha, this guy will make. The guy I stayed overnight with, I went and told him, you know, oh my God, I'm in trouble at school, blah, 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 blah. He said, let's get married. Well, you don't have to wait 3 days in Seattle, or you didn't at that time. We went right up. You didn't have to have anybody. We just got married. That's it. We got married, and now we have to go to work. So in the paper, it said, chorus girls and ushers wanted. Ha ha ha. I went down and there was a whole bunch of girls there to be a chorus girl, you know, to dance. So she said, well, walk to the music. So we walked. Well, of course they're walking, you know, normal. And I'm bouncing along because I'm used to dancing every night, you know, going out. Anyway, so I bounced around and she picked out 12 of us and she picked me out. I'm surprised because the rest were, you know, but I was dancing. Anyway, that's where I started in the chorus line. So I danced there, and Pat would be in the aisle, and while I'm trying to dance up on stage, the steps they taught us, he's trying to do the same steps in the aisle. Well, and he used to come around and call for me. He would yell up the steps, Grassy! You know, Irish accent. He would take me into restaurants and he'd say, the waitress would come up and he'd say, oh, to the waitress, he'd say, I want you to meet my sister. And I'd look at him, you know, here I am, supposed to be his wife. I didn't say anything, but I'd say, what was that? He said, well, you know, she's in love with me. I don't want to, you know, discourage her. Yeah, and so he ran around. Well, what I did is I went home, locked the door, and he had to sleep in the bathroom in the hall. And then I found out I was pregnant, so I thought, what am I going to do here? I'm not going to be able to work after a while, and I don't want to be with this guy who won't be a fit father running around with all sorts of women. So I talked him in and said, listen, I think we can make more money if we go to Los Angeles. Well, I knew my dad's down there. So we went down there. I called my dad. My dad came over to get me. And they almost had a fist fight. He said, that's my wife. You can't take her. My dad said, I'm her father, and I'm taking her. You know. So what he did, he took me. And then after the baby was born, he annulled my marriage.
When I grew up and fell in love, I asked my sweetheart what lies ahead.
Now the greatest one was Joe Miller. Oh, I thought he was the greatest. You know, it wasn't like a young love or anything, but here was a man who I thought was really, and he was kind. There was never a morning that he didn't bring me my coffee to my bed. And no matter what I did, he always, now Grace, you know, buck up. He was marvelous. He used to sing in light opera. His voice, he was a tenor, and when he sang, he did songs like, you know, the audience, this is a burlesque audience, but when he sang, they used to applaud and applaud and applaud. He would have to come back and take a bow. He did that. Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it work against time. Buddy, can you spare a dime?
Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime?
Buddy, can you spare a dime? He was so good. He had the charisma to talk to people,
having worked on stage, he taught me how to talk on stage. He knew the way to talk.
They always used the strip dancers to work in the bits in between. Joe Miller sort of taught me how to talk. They wanted someone just to come on and say, oh, Mrs. Gottrock's lost her jewels, and then go off. That was the hardest thing I ever did in my life. I'm in the wings, I had to walk over to there and back. I thought it was a million miles, and I could hardly get it out, but I did. I'm not exotic as a strip dancer, you realize that. What I did was a burlesque of a strip dancer, more or less, because I would get down, and here's the curtain, and do bumps, 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 and I'd stand up, and I'd fold the curtain around, bumps, and pat it. I'd get down on my knees, you know, and do this, going back, and then I'd come up, and then I'd walk across the stage on my knees. Even when I wore a big picture hat, you know, and it had a hole here, and all I was wearing actually was a brim. So I did that number with I forget the name of the number, but they have four bars where they just beat. So on the music part, I would go like this, and when it comes to the beats, I'd put this down, and you can see my coos with my G-string in the center, and I'd wiggle around. So they see this thing going in the hole on the four beats. Then I'd put it back on my head and go around again. There was one bit I did that Joe Miller just howled at. It's called the Big Apple, you know? And I remember I did it in Canada, and they arrested me. You see, the thing is, these two guys are talking, and they said they're so tired of the gold diggers. What they want, the one fellow says, what I want is a country girl, pure and simple. So before that line comes on, I'm backing on the stage. I've got bloomers below my knee, a short skirt, and a hat, you know, with a flower, and teeth blacked out, a couple of them. And so I'm going out backwards, and I got my finger right up my crotch. That's my first laugh. And, and he says, a country girl, pure and simple. Well, the other guy says, there she is, pure and simple. And he says, well, we're going to have some lunch. I said, that's all right. I brought it. I got some bread and butter sandwiches and some more bread and butter sandwiches. And I'm scratching, you know. He says, don't do that. It doesn't look nice. And I said, sure feels nice. But I got arrested. Because, you know, I mean, I really scratched.
You've been arrested more than once.
Well, you see, after I married Joan Miller, my dad hadn't seen me for a long time. Didn't really know where I was. But he was in the hotel room and his 7 months. He's laying there looking at the paper and it says, the West Theater Rated. And my name is there, Grace Hathaway. Oh, my God. So he found out where I was from the theater, I guess, and he came up to me and said, what kind of cigarettes do you smoke? Well, when we were arrested, we had to go before a judge, the whole show. And I said I was not stripping, I was dancing. I was doing a boogie-woogie. The officer said, well, she took off her brassiere and she threw her, you know, shook her. And the whole cast laughed because mine weren't big enough to shake. The only thing I shook was my brassiere. The judge said, well, I can't really say unless I see it myself. So we had to do a command performance. Well, I tell you, the comic that I did the scene with, the one scene, he said, take it easy. Don't, you know, this is a command performance. Do it, but don't do it. So I couldn't do that. I'm a performer. When I got out there, I not only did it like we did it before, but I embellished it. So when he gave his answer, he says, I don't ever want to see that burlesque scene on stage again. But he said,
I recognize Boogie Woogie when I see it, and that was Boogie Woogie. When I worked in Seattle, and these sailors used to come and see me, and would have me autograph their undershirts, and they put my name on the airplane.
How do you want your name?
You know, they was always putting names.
Right.
Well, I was sad about that because that plane went down and I had my name. He always sat and read about theosophical books about the universe and how we were reincarnated. And he always wanted to be sort of a messiah. But I was still wanting more life, and he wanted to settle back, and he wanted to do this other thing. And when he would talk about this and that, and I'd laugh, and I'd say, well, you know. And he'd say, well, you want to live it, and I want to teach it. It finally came to where he wasn't exciting enough for me. I wanted to get out and get some adventure. So we talked it over, and he said, no, we didn't really talk it over till after I had gone out and had an affair. So, well, what do you mean? Well, you should say.
Who was your affair with?
Oh, it was a bus driver. You know, it was a man anyway. He said, I could take you back, but it would be a sin for me to do that because, he said, you're like a bud that you're just blossoming. And you can't put a blossom back to a bud, so you have to go on with your life and learn what you were after. So that's the way we separated.
How long were you guys married?
13 years. Whenever I got upset, I always went to see him because I knew where he was working. And I would talk to him about my troubles. And he even called up the bus driver and said, now you listen here, what are your intentions towards my wife? You know, and he gave him hell. And the guy said, what can I do? I'm already married, and it's like being against a block wall. So, I mean, well, he straightened him out. He did have one woman he started to live with, but we didn't approve of it, my kids nor I. And Joe and the kids used to put notes, you know, get rid of that old bag and stuff like that under the door. And she would get drunk and come down to the club where I was dancing and start picking up sailors, and I'd have to take her and put her in a cab and take her home to Joe and throw her in the door. And he said, Grace, don't do that, you're embarrassing me. Anyway, then he met Gwen. They were made for each other. So he had a very good life with her. And I don't know what he said to her, but every year, they used to call me on my birthday, both of them. Well, she was very good to me, though. She was a good friend, even though she was after my body.
And more relationship.
Yeah. So she gave me jewels. She bought me muumuus, and she paid all my bills. You know, I mean, she was a good friend. We lived at the Waikiki Tavern. But you see, she was a whore, actually. She used to work the fields, you know, sugar cane fields. And so she started bringing guys into the room next to ours, and getting a little tacky for me. I was working a nightclub in San Francisco, and I had Joe and Tommy board out in Vallejo. And
did you have Betty boarded out then also?
Well, they were all boarded out. Yeah, I got Betty back. Then here comes along Bob Roberts. Have I lost a husband somewhere? He was a cab driver. I was working a nightclub, and he said, I'll meet you out front. I said, okay. But you see, when you drink bees and all that, there's always a back entrance to get away from the guys that'll be waiting for you. So I went out the back door, and there he was. He says, I thought you'd do that. And so he kept following me. And the kids, I remember now, I had them in the hotel with me in the extra room. He just followed me around. He called up, he said, I'm coming up. I said, no, don't come up, I got my kids here. He said, I'm coming up. So I ran next door and I said, come on kids, we're getting the hell out of here. So we went over to Foster's out the back door again, up in the hallway. I didn't even know if there was a back door to the hotel, but there was. We went out over, so he missed us there. But then I wanted to move into an apartment to be with the kids. But what happens? I go to move in the apartment and he insists on going with us. And just when he's settling in, so am I with the kids. I didn't want to live with this guy, he's just moving himself in. Up comes the woman from Hawaii. She had been calling the club and I've been telling him out of town. Here she comes. She knows where the apartment is. She hires two guys to beat up Bob Roberts. She came in with the two guys and they jumped Bob and Bob fought. And there's the kids trying to clean up the blood. You know, clean the house for me. Tommy's out in the street yelling, help, help, please, help, help, please. Then he said, well, I have to stay to protect you. We don't know what might happen here. So there I was living in sin. Everything I made had to go back on me for costumes, for music, and I had children to support. And so I went to school and had to wait table. And I'll tell you, if you don't think that wasn't a laugh, every time I on the ship they said, how come you're working there? And I said, well, I went to school to learn how to be a waitress, and they thought that was funny. But it wasn't funny because I couldn't do a time stamp. That was it. And wait tables. So the way we broke up, he asked me to get off the ship at Christmas time. He said, let's all spend a Christmas together. So when I got off the ship, he told me he was going with another girl, that he was serious about her. Because he didn't marry me, the guy said, he has no rights. The child is all yours. Well, I was off the ship and I went to work at the Franciscan in San Francisco, you know, fisherman board. And while I was working there, he came in to work. And he followed me around all over. And I, you know, just kind of ignored him. And he had one of his friends say, talk to me about going out with him. One day while I was working, he talked to Betty. He packed up all the things I had there. I was really getting into the hippie thing, see.
Was this in San Francisco?
Yeah, I was out in North Beach in this flat. And I was buying furniture and stuff at auctions and getting antiques and just having a ball. So what he did, he talked to Betty. He went and got an apartment in a different district, supposed to be a little higher class or something, and sent all this stuff back, sold it that I had, and got new furniture and moved this into an apartment while I'm working. So when I got there, he took me there, and there's a bedroom for him and I, and bedroom for Betty.
So you guys hadn't been intimate or anything?
No, he just decided that was it. It was time. I thought, well, maybe if I marry him, he'll calm down, and he won't do these goofy things, and it'll turn out nice. So I gave it a go. On my word, they put him in the school. He was only there about a month, and then they got him a ship. So I got him sailing. Joe was in the Army, and Tommy was sailing. I had Betty and Rory in a finishing school in Spolona. Betty was wanting to get a job, you know. That was when she moved up here with me. She said, the finishing school is terrible because Everybody used to sneak out at night. And she didn't. She's very prudish, Betty. You know, she has that nose. I got her on the ship, and that didn't work. And I had taken her to Lake Tahoe and got her a job, working in the fountain in the
ice cream. Yeah.
And then she met Doug Gompers. They said, "Who gives this girl away?" And Joe Miller, "Ha, I give this girl away." Oh, he's a ham, you know. Joe Miller's sister made Betty's wedding gown. And so the wife sat where the mother of the bride sits. I'm there, but I'm in the back. So being a waitress and Sam being a waiter, so we cut the cake and served it. When I was on the ship, I got all the waitresses together and I rehearsed them and we put on a Christmas show. I'm telling you, I put all the numbers on.
That must have been fun.
Yeah, and we, at first, this time I had some girl that sewed and she helped make all the wardrobe. And it was really a good show. It was supposed to be only for the crew. But the captain heard about it, and he brought a guest to come down and see the show. And so it was tradition that I did it every year. So I had to be on whatever ship I was on, that's where the Christmas show was. I'm indisposed. You know what a thrill it is to look out and see people laughing? It looks like ocean waves. Oh boy, isn't it wonderful how we're immortal? Well, I don't want to talk about this. This is really dirty. All this DNA is going out there, and there's no way to kill us off. See, people used to ask for my autograph, and when I became a waitress, they didn't want my autograph.
Right.
They wanted their dessert. We are immortal. Blackout. What will be?